Hello, and welcome to this Texas Instruments training video on design guidelines for the SN65 DSi-83, DSi-84, and DSi-85 devices. This video will provide a step-by-step guide on how to configure the DSi devices for single-channel DSi to single-link LVDS. The SN65 DSi-83, DSi-84, and DSi-85 can all be used in this operating mode, but we will use the DSi-83 for this demonstration. So the first thing you want to do is identify the resolution of your display. For example, from this display data sheet, the resolution is 1024 by 768. Now you'll need to open up the DSi Tuner tool and insert this information in the resolution section. Next, you'll need to go back to the display datasheet and identify the bitmapping format of the display. For example, you can tell that this display accepts JADA, aka Format 1, 24 bits per pixel mapping, where the least significant bits are mapped to the fourth LVDS lane. Now, go back to the tool and fill this information in. Now, you'll need to go back to the display datasheet to identify the timing parameters. The total horizontal pixels, the active horizontal pixels, the total vertical pixels, and the active vertical pixels. The horizontal blanking will be the total horizontal pixels minus the active horizontal pixels, and the vertical blanking will be the total vertical pixels minus the active vertical pixels. Now, go back to the tool and divide the horizontal blanking among HFP, HBP, and the HPW inputs. It does not matter what value each input is, as long as they all add up to the total blanking. Do the same thing for the vertical blanking inputs. Next, go back to the display datasheet to identify the H-sync, V-sync, and display enable polarity. This particular display operates in DE mode, so H-sync and V-sync polarity don't matter as they're ignored. From the diagram, you can see that DE is positive while the display is active, so DE polarity is positive. Go back to the tool and fill this information in. Now, switch to the DSi inputs window. The inputs to this window mainly depend on the DSi source, so I'll be leaving some of the inputs at their default values. But keep in mind that the parameters entered must match the actual DSi parameters transmitted by the source. Now, since the display is 24 bits per pixel, select RGB888 as the video mode. Next, the DSi number of lanes input depends on the required throughput to meet the display resolution. Each lane can support up to 1 gigabits per second. For now, let's assume that all four DSi data lanes will be used. Now, enter the pixel and line information. Typically, this will match what we entered for these parameters in the Panel Inputs tab. Next, enter the LVDS clock value from the display datasheet. Keep in mind that the DSi parts support LVDS clock frequencies from 25 to 154 MHz, so make sure that you're within this range. The LVDS clock can be derived from either the DSi clock or from an external reference clock. If the DSi clock is used to source the LVDS clock, then the DSi frequency is divided by an integer value to obtain the LVDS frequency. If an external reference clock is used, then the external clock frequency is multiplied by an integer value to obtain the LVDS frequency. For this demonstration, we will use the DSi clock to derive the LVDS clock. To determine the minimum required DSi clock frequency, you can use this equation. For this demonstration, the required clock frequency is 195 MHz. Now, fill out the corresponding inputs in the tool. The informational section depends on the DSi source, so we will just leave them as a default value for this demonstration. Now you can click on the calculator icon to get to the outputs window. Make note of the line time requirement. It's very important that the line time on the LVDS side and the line time on the DSI side are the same, or the device may not operate correctly. Next, you can export the DSI file so you won't need to re-enter all of the settings again the next time you open the tool. Next, generate the control status register settings. When this window pops up, you can export the settings to a text file. When you open the text file, the column on the left contains the I2C register addresses, and the column on the right contains the values that need to be written to these registers. Note the sentence at the bottom. It is very important to follow the initialization sequence listed in the datasheet for proper operation of the device. That concludes this video. Thanks for watching.